You're watching a production of South Dakota Public Broadcasting. State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.
Dakota Public Broadcasting's coverage of the Governor's Budget Address. We are coming to you live today from our state capitol and pier. We are in the House of Representatives waiting for Governor Daugaard to deliver the budget address for fiscal year 2013, which will begin this next July. I'm Stephanie Rissler, and as you know, SDPB is committed to our legislative coverage, whether it be on TV, radio, or online. As we begin the new legislative session, you will find that we're going to have some changes to our legislative coverage. That's why today we decided to bring you some of that information at the top of today's broadcast. I've got Bob Bussey, our director of television for SDPB. Bob, tell our viewers about some of the changes they can expect.
Well, absolutely. There'll be a few changes this year. You know, public broadcasting's mission, I believe, is to bring as much unfiltered access to our state lawmakers as we possibly can. And this year, one of the changes that viewers will be seeing is we'll have live broadcasts from the House of Representatives each day. And right after that, we'll have the Senate in its entirety. This will all be on SDPB2. So that'll be each day of the legislative session. We will also have on Tuesday nights in prime time, you know, because you're going to be hosting it, a program talking about the issues going on at Pier that week. And on Friday nights at 8 o'clock, we'll have a wrap-up program that kind of talks about the events of the week here in Pier. And, of course, we'll, as we have in the past on SDPB2, we'll be running live coverage of the leadership and the governor's press conferences on the last day of the week. So it's going to be exciting.
And, of course, none of our online coverage will change at all. Folks can depend on that.
Correct. Everything's online and radio coverage throughout the day.
All right. We are going to now go down to the floor of the House of Representatives, where we have Representative Brian Gosch standing by at the podium.
Ladies and gentlemen, your Lieutenant Governor, Matt Michaels.
Thank you so much. It means a great deal to me. Thank you, Speaker. Ladies and gentlemen of the state of South Dakota, representatives, senators, in accordance with South Dakota Codified Law 479, the governor, through the Bureau of Finance and Management, shall prepare and submit a budget report to the legislature, and copies shall be transmitted to each member of the legislature not later than the first Tuesday after the first Monday in December. Ladies and gentlemen, much has happened these past months to challenge our great state, but with your assistance and support and those of the people of our state, with their resilience and understanding, we've made it. But we couldn't have come this far. We couldn't have taken these steps. We couldn't have done any of it without their tremendous leadership and the perseverance of our governor. Ladies and gentlemen, would the Sergeant-at-Arms please announce the arrival of our governor?
Lieutenant Governor and members of the legislature, the Honorable Governor of the State of South Dakota, Dennis Daugaard.
Lieutenant Governor, thank you, sir.
Governor.
Mr. Speaker, pro tem. Well, thank you very much. Thank you very much. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Please sit down.
No.
Thank you. No, thank you. Okay. Please, thank you. Wow, I'll have to have you in more often. Welcome back to Pierre. It's good to have you back. You know, it gets kind of lonesome around here for Linda and me when you're not here, and we kind of miss you. And the worst part of it is when you're not here, Linda's stuck talking to me. So I know she's glad to have you back. I want to say a special welcome to Senator Kent Junkie and Representative David Scott. Would you stand? And they'll be taking on new roles next year in the legislature. Welcome to both of you. I also want to say a special thanks to Jason Dilges and Liza Clark and Jim Terwilliger and everyone from the Bureau of Finance and Management for their help in putting together last year's budget and then again putting together the budget I'm about to present to you. They worked very hard and we're very lucky to have their able and determined assistance. So thanks to all of you. And I want to thank all of you for joining me today as I offer my proposals for our FY13 state budget. When we met to create the FY12 budget last year, we faced a significant deficit. We recognized we were spending more than we were taking in, and we targeted ongoing cuts totaling $127 million. And everyone participated, everyone, education, Medicaid providers, all the state agencies. Everyone participated, even though it was difficult. And now to sustain these cuts is a necessity. I want to urge that upon you. We now enjoy, because of those cuts, the opportunity to consider investments in key areas. This graph shows how far the deficit developed. Revenue fell in fiscal year 09. Then fell again in fiscal year 10. I can see I've had too much caffeine. And even as those revenues fell, our spending edged up. But the FY2012 adopted budget fixed the structural deficit that was created by the recession. It adopted a conservative revenue estimate, and it brought expenses into line with that estimate. We should all be proud of the work that we've done. This sets the stage for future growth opportunities. Let's take a look at the national economy that we face today. The gray bars on these four charts describe the national economy in terms of its history. The gray bars show history. The blue bars show the forecast that Global Insights, our econometrics firm that advises us, one of the biggest in the world. The blue bars show their forecast with 50% confidence. Normally, when Global Insights gives us their revenue projections and their economic forecasts, they give them with 60% confidence, 60. And then they say there's maybe a 20% chance it'll be worse, a 20% chance it'll be better. This year, they have stated that they have 50% confidence in these projections, and they believe there's a 10% chance it will be better and a 40% chance it will be worse. So that tells us that they believe, those in the business of projecting the national economy, they believe that the future looks better, but they're very uncertain about the dependability of that projection. Let's look at the charts. On the upper left, the U.S. employment declined by 8.7 million jobs during the recession, and only a fraction have been added back. In the upper right-hand side, U.S. housing starts declined from nearly 1.5 million and now are only at about 0.5 million, about a third of what they were pre-recession. The United States' real GDP, here on the lower left, is the only indicator that has surpassed pre-recession levels. But much of that support is due to stimulus spending. And on the lower right, the U.S. unemployment rate remains high at 8.6% presently as the labor market continues to struggle. The bottom line is the economy is recovering, but it has not yet recovered, and we have to be cautious going forward. Let's look at how South Dakota compares to the national economy. The South Dakota economy is performing better than the U.S. economy by many measures. These four charts show four key factors. We focus on non-farm employment because that's a pretty good predictor of what our tax revenue will do. The first graph on the left shows non-farm employment levels of the United States economy on the left axis and South Dakota on the right axis in a ratio scale. And you can see U.S. employment declined much more sharply in the U.S., and the recovery has been slower. U.S. employment declined by 6.3% peak to trough from the top to the bottom. South Dakota only declined about half as much, or 3.1% peak to trough, and our employment growth has been higher than the U.S. recently. The next chart, right up here, you can see South Dakota's unemployment rate remains about half of the United States unemployment rate. And the two graphs on the bottom simply highlight that South Dakota's non-farm income on a quarterly basis, as well as South Dakota's per capita income growth on an annual basis, has grown at a faster rate than the United States over the past 4 to 5 years. We are fortunate that South Dakota's economy was not as impacted by the recession as the United States economy, and that our economy here in the state is recovering more quickly. With that background, let's take a look at revenues. You remember this chart. Last year, we focused on this chart, not last year, but earlier this calendar year when we got together about the budget. And we talked about how in the years 2003 through 2006, we did a pretty good job of predicting revenues in a conservative way, so that at the end of the year, we actually underestimated our revenues. And of course, you want to do that, because if you overestimate your revenues and spend it all, well, you spend money you never got, and that's what gets you into trouble. And in the years 2007 and 2008, we did just that. We overestimated our revenue, and it came in less than what we thought. Not too bad, not too far off, but on the negative side. And we want to be on the positive side. And then along came the recession and really exacerbated that problem. In fact, not only did we overestimate what our revenue was, but we also saw our revenue fall. From 2008 to 2009, it went down. And 2009 to 10, it went down still further. So when we got together last year, one of the things we agreed we needed to do was be conservative about our budget estimates. I challenged us to be conservative with our revenue estimates. And I know that legislative leaders of both parties understand how important it is to rely upon conservative estimates. You did adopt conservative estimates, and between that and an improved economy, we realized actual revenues in fiscal year 11, which were better than we projected. This is something we can be proud of. It is something we should strive for every year. Some will say, oh, we should have spent that money. Well, that's all fine and dandy when you can look back and know exactly what the numbers are. When you can't know what they are, you must conservatively project your revenues and not overspend. We need to continue this cautious, conservative pattern going forward. Now let's look at the year we're in right now, fiscal year 2012. When we left, when you adjourned in March, this was the budget revenue estimate you adopted. Since then, we've had some history. We've had July, August, September, and October revenue, and we built that based on those 4 months. We're starting to now get in November revenue, but these revenue numbers are revised from what we adopted, or you adopted when you left, because we've got a little more history now behind us, and we can see trends better. And you can see we're predicting improvements. Several sources have been revised higher. Sales tax is up 9.6%, 9.6 million rather. Contractors' excise tax is up 10.9%. The bank franchise tax is up considerably. Why is that? We did not budget to collect any bank card tax in fiscal year 12 because we had so grossly overestimated what bank franchise tax would be that we had a debt when we left, when the legislature adjourned. Remember, they had overpaid their taxes, and we owed the banks money, not them owe us. But thankfully, we're again starting to receive bank card tax this year, which is the primary reason for the increase. And then the largest revision down is in the property tax reduction fund, where we're still experiencing the hangover from the smoking ban and the effects of the Iowa casino on nearby video lottery sales. Overall, our ongoing, and I want to focus on that, our ongoing revenue is up by $38.8 million. Contrast that to our one-time receipts, which are up $24 million. One-time is up $24 million because of two things. One, we paid off the bank franchise tax liability early because our fiscal year 11 ending was so strong. Remember, we had those very strong May and June months. And so we paid off the bank franchise tax liability entirely. So we did not have this offset that we had to eat up before we could start recognizing revenue. And then secondly, we had a reallocation of income from prior years by some of the bank franchise taxpayers, and they pushed more of their income into this fiscal year. It hurt them with respect to us because they owed us more tax, but it helped them with respect to the federal government because they owed them less tax. And on balance, it was better for them to make that reallocation, and they did so. Now let's look at fiscal year 13 forecast revenue and compare it to what the changed revenue for 12 is. You can see the change is shows growth in sales and use tax, the property tax reduction fund, and insurance tax, some declines in some of the other areas. Overall, net ongoing is up $22 million. And remember, we were up ongoing for this year $38 million. So we're still trending up, not as much of ongoing increase. You'll see we project a one-time receipt of $28.8 million. Well, how can we predict a one-time receipt in fiscal year 13? Well, it's because I am going to propose that some of the money that we have in this fiscal year, now that we realize our ongoing and one-time revenues are coming in better for fiscal year 12, now that we see that money coming in, I'm proposing we move some of that money and obligate it to be spent in fiscal year 13 to the tune of about $29 million. So that's where that money is coming from, that one-time money, and you'll see that developed. And the total change to ongoing and one-time is $39.5 million. So we've looked at revenues a little bit. Let's look at expenses. And again, we need to move forward cautiously with expenses. Using the reset of state expenditures to realize long-term efficiencies by sustaining the cuts. We talked about the difference between ongoing revenues. We want to invest new ongoing revenues cautiously in targeted areas that can be sustained. One-time dollars should be spent on one-time expenses. And that's why I'm suggesting we take some of our FY12 money, move it into 13 and spend it one time in 13. And you'll see that later in the presentation. And all through this, we want to ensure we don't create a new structural deficit, that we contain our ongoing spending to only be what our ongoing revenue can sustain. And why is it important to sustain the FY2012 cuts? Let's get some perspective on it. Remember, the hard work that we did last year to cut nearly $127 million out of our expenditures. Consider that in FY12, we're seeing, remember, about $38 million in increase and 20-some million in 13. If you start with our actual FY11 revenues, and go to what we project will be our FY13 ongoing revenues, the difference in revenue growth from the end of 12 to the end of 13, 2 years, is only about $63 million. So those 2 years of revenue growth still are only about half of what we had to cut. So we need to be very cautious as we go forward. It has taken 2 years of ongoing revenue growth to pay for just 1 year of expenditure growth in our budget. So without the cuts, we'd still be in a significant deficit situation. Let's move on and look at what we did in fiscal year 11, because that'll help me explain what I propose for 13. During fiscal year 11, we adopted the fiscal year 12 budget. And that 12 budget proposed a 10% cut in funding for K-12, a 10% cut to providers, 10% cut to the Board of Regents, and 10% cut to the state agencies. When we adjourned, that had been amended to some degree. Senate Bill 152 changed the property tax ratio to maintain about 1.4% of what would otherwise be a 10% cut. And then one-time dollars were appropriated to add into both the K-12 providers and the Board of Regents to ameliorate the effects to some degree of this 10% cut. And so you can see the depth of each cut in its respective groups. The state agencies shouldered the entire 10% cut. Now let's look at the increases I'm proposing for this year. Remember, the 1.4% property tax change will be a sustaining change. And so the property taxes were not cut, have not been cut, will not be cut down to create the 10%. So they're starting with that in FY12. Then again, we're going to show the one-time monies that were added. That's where we are in 2012 as you left the legislature. Instead of a 10% cut, we gave them back about 3.5% K-12. We gave back about 4% to the providers and about 0.9% to the Board of Regents. Just recently, the state received $388,000 in one-time money. You might remember that last year, the Ed Jobs Bill provided South Dakota money to be spent in education or in jobs. Other states did not spend their entire allocation, and those funds are redistributed to states that did. We did, and so we get a little share that other states did not spend, and I'm proposing that we distribute our share, the $388,000, directly to the K-12 schools on a per-pupil basis. So with this little revision, this in essence of what is what the schools were receiving in cut reductions, if you will, last year, or the fiscal year we're in right now. Now let's look at fiscal year 2013. We'll start again with the 1.4% that is the Senate Bill 152. Then on top of that, I'm proposing 2.3%. Well, let me say it this way. I'm committed to the notion that in years where we have dollars available, new dollars available, education should receive the first dollars, that is, we should fund the formula, and the last dollars, that if we have money left over, we should send them to education. So this year, I'm proposing those first dollars fund the formula to the tune of 2.3%. That's what the statute calls for, 2.3%. It's based on retrospective inflation rate, 2.3%. So that is what this is. In policy, not in statute, but in policy, we have been traditionally providing also an inflationary adjustment to Medicaid providers, looking at inflation prospectively. And that prospective look forward indicates that a 1.8% inflationary ongoing increase would be provided. And then in the Board of Regents, I'm proposing an ongoing increase to the Board of Regents by 0.9%, just simply based on specific spending requests that they've made. They asked for a fair amount more than this, I'm proposing we give them this, and you'll see more of that in the appropriations bill. So as I previously stated, this shows the ongoing funding that I'm proposing in the FY13 budget. In addition, I'm proposing some one-time spending. I want to use one-time funds to get each increase up to 3% for FY13. So if you start with a 2.3%, we add 0.7% to get these two to add up to 3. The 2.3 is ongoing, the 0.7 is one-time. We also add one-time 1.2%, one-time 2.1% for Board of Regents to get each of the three up to 3%. And these are one-time dollars that I'm proposing we use FY12 money obligated at the end of 12 to be spent in 13 to meet these one-time expenditures. And as you can see, this gets K through 12 above the funding level where they are right now. Gets them a little bit more than the funding they have right now, and they never do fall down to the 10% cut level. I'd like to do the same for these two providers. So I'm going to propose even more one-time funds, another 1.5% for Medicaid providers. On average, they'll get this total amount, and another 1.5% to the Board of Regents, and for the technical institutes as well. They'll be treated the same as K through 12. And then that puts each group in a slightly better position than they are in FY12. Now, I didn't put a 1.5% increase into the K through 12, but I'm going to propose that as well. I'm going to propose we spend an additional 1.5% for K-12 to fund what I'm going to call an investing in teaching initiative. This will be a massive training program this summer and next summer in 4 areas. I've heard many leaders in education worry about the new Common Core curriculum standards. And they say, our teachers are going to be held to these standards, teaching our kids these standards. I have to train them on those standards, and they're going to have to develop curriculum for those standards. We need time and effort and money to do that. And this will fund an intensive training in the summer for every teacher. So these dollars will go right to the teachers. They won't go through the school districts. They'll go right to the teachers. We're also training administrators on the Common Core standards and on new teacher evaluation methods. We're including intensive training for science and math teachers, because this is an important area of emphasis for our students. And I propose also we train guidance counselors to help our students make wise choices as they move through the high school years, so then when they get to the end of high school, they're planfully choosing their workforce career or their technical school or their college career with some guidance help during their high school years. This is a major investment. This 1.5% is over $8 million. And most of this money, as I said, will go directly into the pockets of teachers, both in stipends for attending the training and to the instructors who conduct the training. Now, let's talk about the ongoing general fund increases that these ongoing percentages I just talked about, what they represent. In state aid, it's almost $10 million for technical institutes, $434,000, and these increases do not include additional amounts they'll get for additional student population growth. That'll be shown later. For Medicaid provider inflation, this $6 million sum does not include any expansions for utilization or additional enrollment. This is simply for inflation to serve the same number they're serving today. And for the Board of Regents, this does not include anything for employee compensation. These are simply for program growths. That was ongoing. Now here's the one-time general funds. And as I said, these are dollars that would be spent in fiscal year 13 in this chart. It'll move state aid to 3%, and then another 1.5% on top of that. I talked about being over $8 million, a total of 12 in one-time money. Provider inflation will be total $9 million, but between these two percentage increases, and the technical institutes or the tech schools, 413,000. All told, about 27.8 million in one-time monies in fiscal year 13 coming from FY12, dollars that will be in our pocket already. And then down here you can see that supplemental award that will come in fiscal year 12. Now I want to talk about state employees. Our state employees have gone 3 years without a raise, and they've continued to work hard and serve the state well. I disagree with the caricature that shows government employees leaning on the shovel. That's not South Dakota. Our South Dakota employees work hard, and we've had year after year after year of cuts to their programs. So fewer and fewer people are serving more and more South Dakotans in more and more years using less money, and they're working hard. I've heard from many of you, many legislators, who would like to do something for state employees this year, and I'm pleased we're finally in a position to end the freeze on state employee salaries. I'm proposing two things. First, I'm proposing a $12 million one-time general fund payment to state employees. These would be permanent, non-probationary state employees paid in this year, in FY12, before the end of FY12, that is before June 30th, equaling 5% of their prorated annual salary payable in April of 2012. Neither I nor any elected official would participate. We would also be able to utilize federal and other fund dollars to magnify the general funds and leverage the general funds that we'd be allocating. So you can see this $12 million would be joined by $5.6 million in federal funds and $13.2 million in other funds to make those payments. This payment would not go into their base. It would not go into their base. Just as we're giving one-time dollars to school districts and Medicaid providers, this would be one-time payment to help state employees recover some of their purchasing power that they lost over the 3 years when they got no increase. To give you some perspective, if a state employee would have gotten, say, a 3% increase in each of those 3 years, compounded, that would have been a 9.3% increase on their base. And we would be adding prospectively to that base. I'm not proposing that. I'm proposing a one-time 5% payment to be made in April, and elected officials would not participate. Beyond that, I'm proposing a 3% across-the-board salary policy for employees going forward, starting from their old base from FY9 or whatever it was, and adding 3% to that for FY13. In addition to the across-the-board cut, there would be what we call the PACE system that would move entry-level employees up to job worth over a period of up to 7 years so that they're fully at job worth when they've worked in their job for a long period of time. And also, there are four careers right now in state government that were having trouble recruiting and holding employees in these career bands. Accountants, engineers, nurses, and environmental scientists. We can't recruit them, and we can't keep them because we're so far out of the market with our salaries. And so part of this money is to get us back into the market so we can hire and keep employees in those areas. And then finally, the employee salary package would also include a 3.3% increase in state-paid health insurance costs, what we pay for our state employees to have health insurance. And this takes into account plan changes recommended by the Bureau of Personnel and keeps the program in good financial shape. So this next chart kind of gives you an overview of both the ongoing and one-time funding recommendations in broad summary categories. As you know, in fiscal year 12, we're still using some stimulus money that we got pushed from the Ed Jobs Fund from 11 into 12. About 36, almost 37 million in state aid and Board of Regents payments is made up of stimulus money. And so we have to replace that or they'll fall from current funding levels. This is the last time we'll have a hangover from the stimulus that we have to deal with in our budget. Second thing, $19.9 million is an increase of 2.73 in our FMAP. For every dollar in Medicaid that we spend, we're going to have to pick up $2.73 more, and the federal government will pay $2.73 less of each dollar in fiscal year 13. It's because in those earlier charts you saw, our personal income growth is growing faster than the nation. So we're picking up more burden because we're stronger. 13.3 is the state aid and tech institutes at the 2.3% inflation. It also includes the enrollment growth, technology in the schools, sparsity, South Dakota My Life, that guidance counseling business I talked about. $12 million is that employee compensation package, the 3% across the board. Again, these are all ongoing increases. This group here, all ongoing. So this is the 3% across the board inflation, the careers, accountants, environmental scientists, the health insurance, that's in that number. Then inflation, again, the 1.8% policy-driven inflation for Medicaid providers. We also have to give inflation to our critical access hospitals. We have to reimburse them for their actual costs, qualified health centers, child care. There's a mandated inflation to get the federal match for child care. All those things are essentially inflationary increases that are mandated. Then I'm going to propose, out of the $127 million in cuts, that we restore a small number of them, three of them. $1.2 million for graduate medical education, $250,000 for LRC memberships, and $84,000 for Northern State University e-learning, which helps our K-12 schools. No other fiscal year 2012 cuts are being proposed for restoration. The other state agency cuts will remain. None of the state agency cuts are going to be restored in my proposal. We see about $800,000 in eligibles and utilization growth. For those of you that watched our Medicaid rolls and CHIPS rolls grow at an alarming rate, last year the increase, not the total amount, but the increase that we asked for was $12 million. And the fact that I'm only asking for about $788,000 shows you how the Medicaid growth has abated and slowed and stabilized. So we still have a little bit of Medicaid enrollment growth, but it's considerably less in terms of the rate than it has been. And that's good news. And then another $195,000 in various other increases and decreases combined. Those are the almost $93 million in total cuts that are, total ongoing increases that I'm proposing. And then one-time general funds I've described before that total about $27 million. These are all FY 2013 expenditures, some funded by 2012 money on a one-time basis, others funded there. To execute some of these plans, I'll propose an amendment to the FY 2012 general bill. And these are my proposed amendments. A $12.5 million one-time payment to state employees. I already told you about that. A $5.3 million for immediate workforce needs. I've been spending a lot of time talking to employers and businesses around South Dakota, and I've been hearing a lot of concern. Some of you were in Mitchell yesterday to talk, or not yesterday, but earlier this year, talking about the workforce needs. And I've been hearing, and you've probably been hearing, a lot of concern about workforce. And this budget item is for some initiatives that I will be proposing in detail in my State of the State address. So you'll hear more about it before you need to make decisions about it during the session. I'm going to be proposing $4 million in money to the Railroad Trust Fund to replenish the Railroad Trust Fund in order to match potential federal grants. You know, we've got some Tiger grants in the past that has allowed us to upgrade some of our railroads and move farm products to market better. And we've applied for still another federal grant, and I'm hopeful we might get that, and this would provide matching money for it. A $1.6 million for maintenance and repair. $349,000 in this item. We have available funding in correctional health care based on our current projections, and I'd like to cut those funds and spend them instead under the Department of Health on a one-time basis to pay for flu vaccines in FY2013 for 6 to 18-year-olds who aren't eligible for Medicaid. $39,000 for three new correctional officers that were added to the state pen following the murder of R.J. Johnson. One small amount for home accountant to help us bill for Medicaid and track Medicaid, and then a small cut for DOC teachers. These were previously contracted positions. If we bring them in as state employees, we can do it a little bit cheaper and save some money. So these are the proposed general fund, general bill amendment that I'll offer to you for your consideration. Then we also want to talk about emergency specials. And we have some emergency and disaster issues to deal with, as you know. It's been a difficult year for disasters. Many parts of our states has faced historic flooding this year in the Northeast, up and down the Missouri River, and people from all across South Dakota rose up to prevent disastrous flooding in their areas or to fight the floods and to help those who suffered damage. And I can't tell you how proud I was to be governor of a state like South Dakota when I saw the volunteerism of so many South Dakotans who were helping their friends and neighbors and strangers that they didn't even know coming out to help those who needed help. I've always said that we need to save the state reserve fund for emergencies, and I'm proposing that we pay for $20 million of flood and mountain pine beetle costs out of our emergency reserve fund. As I mentioned, the flooding is about $14 million, and about $6 million is addressing a disaster in the Black Hills. The mountain pine beetle infestation has become an epidemic, and the Black Hills is facing a real danger of massive and catastrophic fire. We've already begun aggressive address to stop the spread of mountain pine beetles, and we need to do more. This is really a case where a stitch in time saves nine. If we act now, in Custer State Park especially, and through the Black Hills, we can protect this treasure as best we can. Here are the emergency specials that I'm asking for. The $20 million would come out of the budget reserve, $14 million for essentially flood relief issues, and $6 million for fire suppression of pine beetles. Of that six, $4 million would be to cost share with private landowners who are adjacent to Black Hills National Forest to encourage them to deal with the problem on their land so it doesn't get onto our land. And also, as I mentioned, in Custer State Park, we felt pretty good about our control efficacy in the park, but in a more recent flyover and on-the-ground checks, we realized that the pine beetles have gotten through our thinned areas and are into the northwest quadrant of Custer State Park in many areas, and we need to attack those vigorously before they spread further. And I know during the session, Custer State Park folks will have maps for you and presentations to show you where we're finding the infestations and the extent to which we're finding them. I'm also asking for $1,300,000 for fire suppression, the special pay fund to fight fires in South Dakota, the extraordinary litigation fund. This pays lawsuit costs we've been ordered to pay. A veterans bonus program, I'm asking for $1 million there. That would cover us for 4 years at $250,000. We had an original appropriation to give special bonuses to veterans returning from the Middle East engagements. And that was during the 2004 session. At that time, it would believe they, we believed by 2011 or 2012, the wars in Afghanistan and Iraq would be over and everyone would be home and we will have paid our bonuses and would be done. Well, as you know, the wars have extended further, and so this $1 million would give us 4 more years of capacity to pay those veterans' bonuses. You've seen the tax refund for the elderly and disabled appropriation before. The SDDA, South Dakota Department of Agriculture Construction, this special appropriation would take $400,000 in savings from our Conservation Reserve Enhancement Program and use it to renovate old Game Fish and Parks property. Game Fish and Parks moved into the new outdoor campus and vacated their property, and we are being kicked out of the Ag Department. Wildland fire suppression people are being kicked out of the airport property where we are occupying. Some federal regulations apparently disallow that kind of function in airport adjacent property. So this money would help us remodel and reconstruct the old Game Fish and Parks property for the uses that the wildland fire people need. Physician tuition reimbursement, that's for one doctor and one dentist who have met the requirements by locating in a rural area and staying a certain number of years. Now we're going to repay their tuition. And then you've seen the water omnibus bill before for water development, solid waste, and water quality improvement projects throughout the state. So those are all the details of emergency specials that I'm proposing as part of the budget proposal. I've been diving into the details, but now I want to step back a little bit and ask you to look once again at the big picture. We still have, in the midst of our improving revenue picture, much uncertainty, much uncertainty. I mentioned earlier how Global Insights has departed from their normal practice of saying, here's what we think with 60% confidence, 20% confidence it'll be better, 20% worse. They're only saying we think it's going to be this way with 50% confidence, 40% confidence it'll be worse. So that tells you even the best economists, the best projection experts in the world, don't know what the future holds, and we don't either. And here are some things that make us uncertain. The failure of the super committee of Congress to deal with the federal budget deficit. Now, those automatic cuts, remember, don't take place until federal fiscal year 2013. So between now and federal fiscal year 2013, we don't know what Congress will do. And yet we have to adopt a budget for our federal state fiscal year 13 without knowing. South Dakota's budget allocations from the federal government are in jeopardy. Also, the sluggish global economy is dragging down and has the potential to drag down not only the South Dakota economy, but the national economy. I'm sure you've been reading in the paper, there's some question about whether in the next 2 weeks we'll even have a euro anymore in Europe, or whether all those European nations that have confederated into the euro as one common currency will break apart and go back to national currencies. And some economists think that that will cause a sharp recession in Europe, and that will impact the United States, and that will impact South Dakota. So that's an uncertainty we face. And then also we've got the healthcare reform that the federal government passed, the Patient Protection and Care Act. As you know, some of the provisions of it have come into play already, but many of the most significant provisions come into play in 2014. And so the decisions we make in 2013, in terms of ongoing spending, we need to be aware, we need to sustain them in 2014, even as we shoulder some uncertainties as a result of the Health Care Act. Now, I don't know whether the Supreme Court will strike down parts of that act, all of that act, none of that act. I don't know, and you don't know. And yet we have to make a budget. So the point I'm making is all these uncertainties cause us to need to be very conservative on how we commit to future ongoing expenses. So here's the bottom line. In fiscal year 12, Our recommended receipt projection now is that we'll bring in $1.236 billion. And the expenditures I am proposing will, on an ongoing basis, expend $1.198 billion. And then I'm saying, on a one-time basis, some more of those, and then $27.8 million, I'm saying, let's obligate them on a one-time basis to be spent, to be receipted and spent in 2013. And there are $10 million that I'm not proposing to spend in any way at all. I'm leaving $10 million on the bottom line. Because we live in a time of uncertainty, I'm not spending every dime we expect to get. $10 million is less than 1% of our revenues. I'm proposing to spend over 99% of the revenue we receive and leave $10 million as a contingency. If our revenues come in as we hope they will, and if our expenditures are as controllable as we hope they will be, that $10 million on the bottom line will be swept by state law into our budget reserves. And remember, I'm proposing to spend $20 million of those reserves, so this would in part replenish that if it's not needed for other things. And the same is true in FY13. I'm proposing to spend $12 million less than we take in, including the one-time money that we take in, and leave $12 million on the bottom line as a contingency against some of these uncertainties. If revenue comes in as we think it will, and if we're able to control our expenses to the degree we think we can, then that $12 million will also get swept in reserves. But if we have problems, if revenue drops, if we double-dip recession because of Europe or the federal government, or if we have expenses that are unforeseen because of the federal budget problems, then we've got a little bit of room, less than 1% room, but we've got some room. So I hope that you will leave that money on the bottom line for that kind of contingency. If you do, and if it remains on the bottom line at the end of each fiscal year, this is what a chart of our emergency reserve history will look like. Going back to fiscal year 03, we had a little less than $110 million in reserves. We got some federal dollars that we bankrolled, and our reserves went up by quite a bit. We spent some of those reserves to fund a home state mine. We spent some other reserves along the way. And then the reserves have been held at about $107 million, talking about the budget reserve and the property tax reduction fund together. They totaled $107 million. I'm proposing we spend $20 million, and then if it remains on the bottom line at the end of fiscal year 12, 10 of it would bring us back, and then $12 million at the end of fiscal year 13, again, if it's there, would bring us back to about 110, so a little bit above where we stand today. Now, let's return to a historical perspective. This chart's familiar to you. It shows ongoing revenue against ongoing expenses. Our goal is to have these lines track as closely as possible. They diverged widely after the 2008 recession. Because of your hard work last year, these lines once again track each other. Because of a strengthening economy and improving revenues, we are projecting surpluses in both fiscal year 12 and fiscal year 13. Some people still don't believe that we made the right decision last year. They believe we should have spent the reserves, avoided the tough decisions, and kicked the can down the road. They claim to support making cuts, but they opposed every cut, every specific cut that was proposed and offered. Let's look at what would have happened if we had adopted their plan. This would be our situation today. Even with improving revenue projections, and even with only mandatory spending increases, FMAP increases, inflationary increases mandated, we'd be running an $88.7 million deficit for this year, fiscal year 12. and we'd be looking at a $116.7 million deficit for FY13. Our reserve funds would be completely gone, and we'd be $100 million in the hole. We'd be confronting massive deficits like many other states are still confronting. Instead, our budget is healthier, our unemployment is lower, our growth in personal income is higher. Standard & Poor's has upgraded our credit rating in South Dakota, even as they downgraded the federal government's credit rating. There is one area where we can improve, however. We have a long tradition in South Dakota of requiring a balanced budget. Many of us, myself included, are proud to tout that our Constitution requires a balanced budget. In fact, even the National Council of State Legislatures lists South Dakota as among the states that has this requirement. We discovered this year, though, as we worked with Standard & Poor's to upgrade our bond rating, that this requirement is pretty difficult to find in the Constitution. You can imply it from a couple of provisions read together, but there is not a clear, explicit requirement in the Constitution of a balanced budget. In fact, Standard & Poor's refused to credit us with having a balanced budget requirement in our Constitution because of this ambiguity. We already hold ourselves to the balanced budget requirement, and we should make that very clear in our Constitution. I'm asking the legislature this next session to pass a joint resolution to provide a constitutional amendment that requires the governor to propose and the legislature to adopt a balanced budget every year. I hope this will help South Dakota improve and upgrade its bonds from AA plus to AAA. But even if it doesn't, it reiterates an important principle to our elected officials and to our friends in Washington about the importance of a balanced budget. I said it last year, and I'll say it again. South Dakota has the opportunity to show other states that there's a better way. We balance our budget every year. We create stability in state government at a time of instability in our federal government. We avoid raising taxes, and we maintain reasonable regulation. And we earn a higher credit rating to demonstrate our strength. Right now, in Washington, D.C., and in Sacramento, and in Albany, and in St. Paul, they are contending with massive budget deficits. They are still spending money they don't have. Meanwhile, here in South Dakota, we're taking care of business. We balanced our budget last year, and we will keep our budget balanced by being cautious and conservative. As a result, this session does not need to be about more cuts. We can focus on making government better through investments. We are in this position because of your hard work, and I'm proud of what we accomplished. I know that as long as we stay true to our principles, we will build an even stronger South Dakota. Thank you.
Thank you, everybody. Thank you, everybody, for coming. We are officially done for today. Thank you.
And there, Governor Dennis Daugaard just delivered the budget address, South Dakota's budget for fiscal year 2013. Very different than what we heard last year. The last thing that the governor did have to say, this session is not about more cuts. It's about making South Dakota better through investments, some of those investments. we will see more money for education. We'll see more money for medical services for the poor. State employees will see a raise this year. On top of some of these ongoing, ongoing money that will go through different state agencies, we'll also see some one-time funds that will go to education, to state employees. Just to kind of break it down for you, and just a reminder, we'll have Kara Hetland on the floor doing some live interviews with some state lawmakers, so stay with us for that. This is what we will see. K-12 education will get a 2.3% increase in ongoing funding. On top of that, they will receive a one-time fund of $12 million. Medicaid, 1.8% increase in ongoing funding, coupled with a $9 million one-time fund for Medicaid service providers. State employees, we are going to see a 5% one-time payment that will be delivered to state employees this fiscal year, which means it will come to state employees if they are currently a state employee, not under a probation period. They'll get that 5% one-time fund before July 1st. And on top of that, they will also be receiving a 3% pay increase. Now, again, this is the governor's proposal. All of this will have to go through the legislature this coming legislative session. It will all end up in a general bill, which, of course, our state lawmakers will have to approve, and then we'll make it to the governor's desk. This is what Governor Daugaard is proposing for the fiscal year 2013. Very optimistic, yet very cautious. He's told lawmakers because they were able to meet that $127 million shortfall last year, it has allowed South Dakota to be in the position that it is today. One of the things the governor said, by being frugal, we have successfully achieved a new normal and can more optimistically plan for the future. So there you have it. As we move forward for fiscal year 2013, lawmakers are still mulling about in the House of Representatives as Governor Daugaard exits. And right now, I think what we'll do some interviews. I believe Kara Hetland is on the floor of the House of Representatives. We'll hear from her right now.
Okay, and thanks, Stephanie. And Representative Susan Wismer is with me, a Democrat from Britain and also a member of the Appropriations Committee. It seems to me your work might be a little easier this year, do you think?
Oh, theoretically, yes. But yeah, it'll be nice not to have to talk about additional cuts. But really, schools and Medicaid providers are going to be dealing with cuts that we instituted last year, and they really aren't going to be remedied much at all. The 2.3%, I believe, that he mentioned for education and 1.8 for Medicaid are a very small portion of the cuts that they suffered last year. So that and a combination, that combined with the fact that he's using a lot of one-time funds, is going to make budgeting so much more difficult for all of our superintendents and our nursing home administrators around the state. When I think of trying to put together a budget that incorporates all those different facets of one-time monies, I'm thinking, oh, we're really asking, we just keep asking more and more and more of our K-12 and Medicaid providers. And so it's going to continue a lot of pain for them in particular.
Because some of that one-time money, that increases in the proposal to almost 6% increase for K-12 education. Is that correct? So that would be quite a chunk to have to make up?
If we think about, if we're only thinking of the last 9 months, but if we think in terms of the last 10 years, education is dealing with essentially 10% less still than what they would have had if we had stuck with the funding formula. And so this only recoups a very small portion of it, and then the extra part that it above that is one-time money. So it's money that they can't count on. So they can't plan on keeping that teacher on board, because you can't pay a teacher with one-time money year after year.
Representative Wismer, thank you very much for your time today. Appreciate it. Stephanie, back to you.
All right, thanks, Kara. Now I am joined by Representative Peggy Gibson from Huron, education always a big issue for you and something that's been important to you in the legislature. We did hear Representative Wismer also touch on education, but I want to hear from you what you think about the ongoing increase as well as the one-time funds.
Well, it's certainly refreshing not to hear that we're going to have a cut. However, education is still 4 years behind overall, so we're not even really catching up to date. We still need to come a long way in education. I'd like to see a completely new formula written for education.
All right. Now, just give me your overall general thoughts on the governor's budget proposal. Again, this is his proposal. How it ends up in March is everybody's guess, but your thoughts right now.
Well, we don't have any long-term commitment here. We have some one-time monies coming in. Those are Band-Aids. And we need a vision. We need some real true leadership that I'm not seeing coming from the governor.
On top of that one-time fund, state employees will get a one-time fund increase before the end of this fiscal year, as well as a pay increase. Your thoughts on that?
Well, I'm very happy to see our employees finally get some money for their hard-earned work. However, I don't like the one-time money, the 5% bonus going to employees who are making, say, more than $100,000 to $150,000 a year. I'd like to see that prorated with our middle-income employees and see them get the money rather than our high-end employees.
All right, very good. Representative Peggy Gibson, thanks for coming up. We'll see you in January.
Yes.
All right, Kara, we'll now throw it down to you.
All right. Thanks, Steph. And Senator Russ Olson is with me now, the Senate Majority Leader. Thanks for being here right now. And tell me your reaction and your thoughts about the budget proposal.
Yeah, it's kind of a nice affirmation that those long winter cracker barrels and public meetings and all of the emails and phone calls that we got from constituents that questioned the need for the budget cuts last year to get rid of that structural deficit, those of us that believed in the cuts, I think, get a little bit of an affirmation now that they were the right things, and now we can start concentrating on reinvesting in programs instead of using those dollars to pay down debt service.
Will it be mostly one-time money to reinvest, or is that just kind of a bonus to put in strategic places?
Yeah, you know, I mean, the governor's famous for saying, you know, this is a plan and not the plan. So now that he's laid it out, I think that, you know, we spent a large part of last year with a lot of our members having great ideas for different and new programs and expansion of programs that they had to put on the shelf because they were, quite frankly, knew that there was no money to invest in those programs. So I think that this year we're going to see a lot more of those great ideas come to the top.
And do you think there will be support? The governor really didn't come up with any new programs, but just maintaining where we are right now for one more year?
Yeah, you know, there's always some tweaking that can be done. Large school of thought thinks and thought last year that the $107 million that we had in reserves wasn't enough. It was less than a month's operating expenditures for the state. And so now dipping down even lower into that, I know there's people that want to build those reserves back with the good. While the times are good, you make hay when the sun shines.
And as Senate Majority Leader, is your recommendation to start with this proposal and tweak it? Or do you recommend coming up with whole new programs, whole new ideas?
Yeah, like I said, I know we have a lot of our members that have got some ideas of their own. They had great ideas last year. We asked them to put them on the shelf until the financial times for our state turned around. And now that we're in the top 10 economies in the nation, I think it might be the time to start looking at some of those ideas. We have a lot of folks that want to invest in education, higher ed, research and development, infrastructure of our roads. There's a lot of things that I think that you're going to see a lot of good program ideas come out of the Senate.
Senator Olson, thank you so much for being there. I appreciate it. Stephanie, back to you.
All right. Thanks, Kara. We're now joined by Senator Mark Johnston from the Sioux Falls area. Thank you, Senator, for being with us. As always, we want to know your overall thoughts on what you heard today.
Well, it's better news. Last year was my first session, and, man, what a great first session to not have it was a terrible budget situation. Really right off the top, our economy is recovering, but it's not recovered. And so the approach that the governor's taken to make some real targeted strategic investments, I feel, is the right solution for this point in our state's history.
All right, let's talk about some of those investments. We'll hear a lot about K-12 funding, but when we look at higher education and our tech schools, anything kind of shock you or come to mind when the governor touched on those?
Well, yeah, a little bit, because, you know, the scale of the dollars is much higher for K-12 because of the numbers. But at the same time, I've continued to ask questions and talked about creating a single system of education so that wouldn't create such a big disparate group between K-12 and higher ed. The tech schools, they're great, one of the greatest values in education to the state of South Dakota. They're getting some of the smallest increases dollar-wise, but they're serving more and more students as our kids and even non-traditional students, the working adults who are going back to get higher levels of education. So I really think there's not very much parity in the education community, and that's a challenge for me.
One of the things that the governor talked about at the end of his speech was the requirement that South Dakota is required under our Constitution to have a balanced budget. And come to find out, there's a little ambiguity in there, and the governor will ask the legislature to make sure that is solid in stone. Your thoughts on that?
Absolutely. And the Constitution says we can't spend more than we take in. It's that simple. But it doesn't clearly call for a balanced budget mandate. And so that's really what he's talking about. That's been, you know, that's who we are. That's South Dakotans. We don't spend more than we take in. We pay our bills when we get them. And you know, that's how you and I operate our own checkbooks. And so it's probably a good idea that we put that into a little bit firmer language in the Constitution.
And before I let you go, real quick, we'll hear a lot about ongoing revenue and one-time funds. When we talk about Medicaid, they'll see an increase, but they'll also see some one-time funds.
Yeah. The Medicaid money is not equal. There are providers in this state that took a much greater cut than as a percentage than some of the other provider groups. And those cuts, and especially because of the types of their business, predominantly hospitals, physicians, they took a significant dollar cut. And so I'm really concerned about the formula that the governor lifted up today, and I think there needs to be a little bit more parity in the way those Medicaid dollars are reallocated going forward.
Right, interesting. Well, we'll keep our eye on it as the legislature convenes back in January. Again, Senator Mark Johnston from Sioux Falls, thanks for being with us, Senator.
Thanks.
All right. Kara, back to you.
Thanks, Stephanie. And Representative Melissa Magstad from Watertown is here. Your second budget address, correct?
Second budget address, right. Yes.
And so this one a little easier to hear?
It was a lot easier to receive the starting point from today's conversation than it was a year ago.
And you work in the healthcare industry, and what are you hearing? What do healthcare providers want most of all?
You know, I think there's an acknowledgement that healthcare does need some reform. I mean, that's a general acknowledgement among healthcare providers, but also I think among citizens that something needs to be done about that. And we just happen to be in those transition years, reflected in budgets that have been taking a beating in Medicaid reimbursement and healthcare reimbursement, and even our FMAP. From our federal dollars for our Medicaid. All that is in transition right now. And it's reflected in knowing change needs to happen, but it still makes you nervous. Uncertainty.
What kind of reform can happen at the state level?
I think most people would be surprised that the Medicaid program is administered mostly by state regulations. There's a few things that are federal requirements that we must do. Eligibility is one of them. Some of the other requirements that we have to maintain federally, but it is administered by a lot of rules and regulations that come from the state level. So it very much is tied to state business.
Any new programs that you want to see brought up, or do you believe that the state budget needs to just maintain status quo for another year?
You know what I'd really like to see, and I think it's been coming up even the last year, is greater efficiencies in how we administer programs. When we designed even the Medicaid system, when we designed systems just in general for our government, could have been 40, 50, 60 years ago. And it's a different environment that we function in. And so maybe last half a century's design was perfect for that point, but it's not maybe the best way to do it now. And so I heard that there are going to be a lot of bills coming into our committee from those agencies looking at becoming more efficient, looking at increase in accountability and how Medicaid dollars are used and dispersed, individually and to providers, and making sure that we have that clarity of how we are doing our program in the most efficient, accountable way. So I'm looking forward to the bills that will be coming forward through the committee.
All right, Melissa, thank you so much. Representative Melissa Magstad, Stephanie, back to you.
All right. Thank you, Karen. Now we have the Senate Minority Leader, Jason Furyk, with us. Thank you for being with us, Senator. Again, we're just trying to get lawmakers' thoughts today. What did you think about what the governor had to say?
Well, what continually is in my mind is as I think about where are we going to be these next 3 years. Our governor has laid out where this next year looks like, but I certainly would welcome more of a long-term approach. In all reality, certainly the governor's 1 year into his year of serving our state, but he's halfway through his budget addresses. And so it really begs the question to me of where does he want to be? And who is more important to have as informed on that long-term vision are our local players, which are school districts, nursing homes. You know, those are the people who really need to know and want that certainty to be informed of where the state will be at to partner with them.
Now, the governor applauded the legislature, you being the minority leader. He indicated that if you guys would not have done what you did last year, which was make those cuts so we would not have that $127 million shortfall, we would be in a much different spot than we are today. Do you, I guess, accept those applauds from the governor and agree with him on that?
Well, I do disagree with the governor, and I think it was fair enough for him to lay out where a few options could have been going forward. However, he is wrong in the aspect to say that that we, if he was referring to us as Democrats, that we opposed every single cut. We certainly asked for cuts throughout the bureaucracy of state government. We said that those cuts, which are standing as we go forward right now, the governor proposes not to roll back any of those cuts. And so we said take that three-year approach, spread it out over the course of 3 years, knowing that our revenues would increase. And so I think the slide that he put up certainly would have just said to not accept any of the cuts. And we said as Democrats, there are some cuts, there is some pain that needs to happen. But let's hold harmless areas in K-12 education and in Medicaid as much as possible. Certainly, they maybe had to have been cut a little bit, and those could have been sustained because we know we have this increased revenue. So it's just a matter of which way the person wants to have the numbers look. I respect the governor, but I think he's dead wrong in the way that he presented that slide because, like we said, spread that out over 3 years. And of course, as far as the increase in revenues, spread that $127 million out over the course of 3 years to make those cuts. We would have been very close in the ballpark and pretty much right in tune with where we're at. And certainly, there still is the rest of this fiscal year to finish. And as we just look at things, we know that in terms of revenues in our state, the agriculture economy is booming and continues to be rock solid. And we don't see that withering away. We certainly hope that unforeseen natural disasters can be minimized as much as possible. But at the same time, I am still confident and I stand behind my efforts along with others that agreed with me that we could have spread those cuts out over 3 years and not had to have the sticker shock that everybody has throughout South Dakota by having to take care of the huge extreme cut that was put in place by the governor last year.
You mentioned the natural disasters. Let's talk about that. South Dakota had some devastating natural disasters, one being the flood of the Missouri River. But up where you are in the Wilmot area, there's a lot of flooding that's going on. Give us your thoughts on the idea to take $20 million to handle not only flooding issues, but the mountain pine beetle issue.
You bet. Well, this disaster aid is something that's very typical that, something needs to be taken care of. What has been done by seeing these numbers is we see that throughout state government, if there is a will and an opportunity, we can find some money to work with. And I think when you look at the money for natural disasters, certainly he's talking about taking it back out of the reserves to replenish the funds that he used to pay some of those expenses and to take care of these ongoing expenses for various types of disasters. I'm glad to see that the state has finally decided to allocate those funds and pay their share. But that's only the 10% involvement for the FEMA a match. And so our local effort, I believe, is 15% because it's 75% from the feds based on FEMA. And so, you know, that doesn't mean that he's allocating funds to help out our local governments, townships who have an exhausted road budget because they had to replace even just one bridge, or they had to replace a culvert that maybe was blown out, in our counties that are trying to just, you know, maintain their roads that are much less than even gravel turn into mud and things like that. So really this, I wish it could give more hope to folks back home, but this just basically means from a state perspective where those funds will be allocated. I am glad to hear, though, that at least he said that it pertains to natural disasters throughout our state. If it would have been narrow-minded, as in just the Missouri River, certainly we would have cried foul and wondered why he didn't take care of folks across our state who have been suffering due to natural disaster. As far as mountain pine beetle, I have been out there and witnessed and been able to see the impact, and it certainly is very devastating. It's very scary. Myself, as a farmer and rancher up, like you mentioned, in the Wilmot country, I'd like to do anything I can in terms of running my operation and how I can mitigate problems and of course, minimize risk. And I understand this, the mountain pine beetles, by taking care of those trees and getting this done, you know, this winter, if possible, is extremely important. So I think it's well-intentioned. On the backside, we need to continue to remember that there still are folks throughout our state who are suffering, whether it be, you know, those who are working two or three jobs trying to make ends meet, whether it's the amount of kids that we have in the Medicaid programs, very scary. And so in all of this excitement that we don't have to worry about cuts, there still are real people throughout our state who are suffering.
All right, very good. We have, of course, with us our Senate Minority Leader, Jason Frerichs. Thanks for speaking with us today, and we'll see you when the session convenes in January.
Well, certainly. Thanks so much for coming out to appear, Stephanie, and very good to see all of the crew from Public TV.
All right, very good. And that will conclude SDPB's coverage of the governor's budget address for fiscal year 2013. Just a reminder, we will be back in January as the 2012 legislature begins with the kickoff of the State of the State address. And, of course, our committed coverage, whether it be on television, radio, and online, you know you'll find it on SDPB when it comes to the legislature. For all of us, we thank you for being with us.
State House program funding provided by the South Dakota Bar Foundation, the educational and charitable arm of South Dakota lawyers and judges.